Plastic is at the centre right now of a global environmental alert, a toxic danger to the health of our planet. But we depend on it for so much of what we do. So how do we kick an addiction to plastic? And are the alternatives really better for us? You're watching Roundtable. And welcome to the programme with me, David Foster. Mountains of plastic waste are filling up landfill sites, they're clogging up our oceans, getting into the food chain, and some governments, well, they are trying to move beyond plastic, but that itself apparently could have unintended consequences.
Around the world, humans produce about 300 million tons of plastic waste every year. Half of all plastic is designed to be used only once, including 5 trillion plastic bags purchased every year, according to the UN. 91% of all plastics are non-recyclable, and by 2050 there will be more plastic in the oceans than fish by weight. Canada and the EU have announced bans on single-use plastics by 2021, Kenya has banned plastic bags, and Taiwan's ban includes straws and utensils. However, academics from the Harriet Watt University say a ban on plastics could result in more environmental damage, as replacing them with other materials could increase the energy used and so contribute to climate change. So can we kick our addiction to plastics? And are the alternatives any better?
Very pleased to say that joining me at the round table we have Claire Potter, campaigning for an end to single-use plastics. That's the plastic-free pledge. Diana Szpotowicz is here, who runs a leading plastic-free online business, The Weekly Shop. Emma Revell from the Institute of Economic Affairs is here to talk about the costs. And on the line from Keele University in the UK, Sharon George, an expert on environmental sustainability. Sharon, we'll come to you first, since you study this on an almost daily basis. Are we addicted to plastic, as we said?
We are addicted to plastic. Plastics now have infiltrated every part of our society and the way we live. So if we imagine a world, if we just click our fingers and plastics go away, this is going to affect our electronics, it's going to affect our food supply, it's going to affect the way that we manufacture and the way that we get goods to consumers. So, you know, everything that we wear, it's become so ingrained with every single part of the way that we live now, it's going to be very, very difficult to move away from.
We'll talk about the alternatives throughout the course of this programme, but when, Claire, you first of all, when did it become public enemy number one?
I think plastics and material is something we've become very used to, as Sharon's already said. It's been ingrained in our everyday. And it's something that we didn't really pay a huge amount of attention to because we didn't. But there's been a few markers of things that have happened in the last few years which has really brought plastic as a material to public's attention. So the fact that recycling is so complex and the fact that there's reports about recycling going elsewhere, getting exported and not being actually recycled like we think. But the big point was Blue Planet for a lot of people, them understanding the Blue Planet effect, as we call it in the studio. The fact that your implications on your actions on an everyday...
We're talking about a massive TV series.
Huge TV series.
By the world-famous and much-loved David Attenborough.
Yeah, and global as well.
Yeah. So which even talked though... about what was happening underneath the surface of the ocean, for those that hadn't seen it.
And stuff that you don't see. So, of course, that magic place of away, the ocean is one of the magic places of away. And suddenly people were looking at things in Blue Planet 2 and understanding that that straw, that cotton bud, that plastic bag, that wrapper could have been theirs. So there was a link between an implication and an action and a consequence.
It's all very well to say how awful it is, but what alternatives are there?
It really depends on what you're looking at. It is incredibly complex to swap up a material that is so cheap to produce, is so easy to produce, and is so lightweight. And when you look at carbon footprint, and if you look at how much energy it takes to transport all of our stuff all over the world, how our aeroplanes fly, how our mobile phones work, how our technology works, to replace a material in one way might be incredibly complicated, but then there are lots of alternatives to other things that are a lot simpler.
It's about changing people's ways of life, and you, to some extent, well, you think you're on the way to doing that with the weekly shop. How does your business work?
Absolutely. So the weekly shop helps consumers make small changes at home. So for things in the kitchen, in the bathroom, as well as their on-the-go kind of weekly shop, it's helping them to encourage them to make small little changes.
And buy small little amounts of things?
Well, I
think... Each one of which requires quite a big little journey.
It can do.
If you transport in bulk in plastic, you might be actually using less energy than you would sending out 25 bars of wonderful soap unwrapped in different journeys.
Well, the really nice thing is that, so for example, in my shop, and I know others do this as well, I really try and source products that have a local footprint. So the majority of my products are made in the UK, handmade in the UK. And in fact, what I try and do is make the story and the journey of those products quite transparent. So I have fantastic products that are handmade by Debbie in Wales, or I have another product that...
What if somebody in Inverness wants them?
Pardon me?
North of Scotland from Wales. That's quite a journey.
It is quite a journey.
Would you not send it there?
I would send it there, but like I said, these are all small little changes that...
So it's a start, but it's the cost of everything, isn't it? I mean, plastic's very cheap. It's readily available. It's lightweight. There's a cost to this, isn't there?
There is, and it's about how easy it is for people to make those changes as well. So businesses like yours make it very easy for people to do that. One of the biggest problems when it comes to changing plastic is that people's stated preferences are for more recyclable materials. If you ask people, they go, oh, yes, I would love to recycle, I'd love to use things that have a lower carbon footprint.
Okay, but they're revealed, take a look at this.
Their revealed
take
preferences
a look at this
are
behind
different.
Me. The bottles are probably recyclable.
Possibly,
the tops... probably aren't.
And that will differ depending on where you live.
And that is bonkers.
It's not. That's not the way to make it easy for people. And it does vary from council to council. It's often quite easy to recycle at home with curbside recycling, but it's very difficult to recycle if you're out on the go. So if you buy one of these bottles, if you buy a bottle of water and you finish it on the bus, you're probably not going to hang on to that and deposit it in the curbside recycling at home. So it's about making it easy for people.
Okay. Sharon, let me come to you. Many years ago, I was a reporter in the United States, and I've said this on air before. I went to a house that was the house of the future. It was supposed to be the house of the future. And it had a hole in the worktop into which you dropped your plastic bottle. It chewed it up and reduced it to plastic crystals, which at the end of the week you put into a container of some kind, and it was picked up. It was about that size, and let's say it was 40 to 50 bottles. Now, even now, we still have to have a lorry that size, the size of this room, to take away those 40 or 50 bottles. Why haven't we gone any further?
I think we've become... It's, part of the problem has been the cheapness of the material, and we've been treating this material as disposable for too long. So, at the moment, the facilities that we have with the range of plastics that we've got. Part of the problem is the different types of plastic that we've got. So if we just had less types of plastic that were more universal, then recycling would be easier. And having and that is exactly what we need to move to, are things that make it easier for people at home to just have, to just be able to know, they look at that packaging and know that is definitely recyclable, and that is definitely how I deal with it. And that's not happening at the moment.
You see, I have this concern that we're identifying plastic as the big villain at the moment, when in fact there are so many other things out there that are equally as bad, Sharon, and they're getting ignored, perhaps.
They are. I mean, we're focusing on single-use plastics. And there are, just sticking with plastics for a second, there's loads of plastics that aren't, they're not really in the public eye as much. So we all know about e-waste. So, most people now have got a mobile phone. Most people have got a mobile phone charger. Most people in their drawers at home have old mobile phone chargers, and they have a lot of old electronics.
I've got loads.
Yeah. And all of those electronics, the supply chain for those is equally broken. Does anyone know where a way is for this? And the plastics that are involved and the metals that are involved in those electronic products are extremely toxic. And I have a problem with this ethically, because if we're not dealing with... We're okay with consuming on our own soil, but we're not okay with dealing with the waste on our own soil. And in a developed country where we have technology, we really seriously think that we can just export this problem to another country to have advanced technology to deal with this stuff safely. And some of these plastics have fire retardants, and you know that some of the minerals and things that are used in the electronics are highly toxic.
Can I ask you this one? Is it your sense that campaigners such as those we have in the studio, with the best intentions in the world, are actually drawing the spotlight away from issues that could perhaps be more concerning to us all? And we'll talk about the cost, Emma, in a moment, but that's for you, Sharon.
Well, I think that the role of these campaigners is really important. And there is a move away from the spotlight, but everything can't have the spotlight. What I think the role of these campaigners are is to put the spotlight on solutions, and some of the solutions around those products that offer an alternative. We need to create new markets and new opportunities and new materials. So that's a gap for businesses to jump in there, and the role of these campaigners, these small groups, then establish these new products that then can then get rolled off get cheaper. And
I'm going to put you in the spotlight, Claire, and say, what solutions have you come up with?
It really depends on the actions that you're looking at.
That sounds like a politician's answer.
Well, some are very...
What solutions have you come up with?
Okay, so give you an example. I was doing a talk, and I run a circular economy design studio. That's the day business. So I do a lot of talks around behaviour change generally. And one of the talks I was giving, somebody came up and said, OK, tell me what I need to buy to be plastic-free and to have a zero-waste lifestyle. I was like, OK, right, well, it really depends on how you live your life. And I was like, you could have this, 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 and this. For example, like a reusable coffee cup. And I went, great, I'll go and buy one. Which is the best one? I was like, well, how often do you have coffee out? Well, I don't really have coffee out. I'll just go and sit in a coffee shop. And I'm like, well,
then don't buy
a reusable coffee cup. I travel a lot, so a reusable coffee cup is like number one or number two on my list. So even though people look at these wonderful, beautiful Instagram stories, hashtag zero waste, minimalism, you really need to think about how it fits in your life.
But what you're doing is you're offering advice. But what practical solutions have you come up with?
From the campaign's perspective, we're actually looking at how we can highlight options to people. And I think the role that we have as campaigners and as educators, which is what we are, is to allow people to make an informed choice and feel empowered. And I think for a long time, people have felt that they put their recycling in a recycling bin, it goes away and it removes the responsibility. When actually we can all look at all of our lives and we can look and see what fits with us. So actually highlighting what is it refillable things for you? If you've got a refill station close to you for shampoos, great. Maybe it's actually going plastic free completely.
Or like a petrol station.
Yeah, so you like a patch.
I'm terribly sorry, I don't live in London, but they exist.
Actually, there's actually far more refill shops, as they're being called, or zero package or unpackaged shops, developing across the whole of the country. But it does mean that it is suitable for some people who can, if they have one locally to them, or can shift their consumer behaviour. And also the cost that goes with that.
OK, so I have to go and start looking for that.
Yeah, there's a variety of things that you can do.
Can I ask you about the stuff and the ideas behind it in just a moment? But what, Emma, what about regulation? Why don't we make it much more costly for those people that pollute in this way with plastic to do so?
Because what that would actually do is make it costly for the people who consume that plastic, because those costs are just going to be passed on.
Not
to
a problem
the
there?
Well, if you're buying a lot of plastic bottles, then
okay, put a penny on a bottle, and if it gets rid of the problem, I'm okay with that.
It's probably not going to get rid of the problem, because what? Deposit return schemes, for example, in Germany found is that there was a shift away from recyclable material into non-recyclable alternatives because businesses didn't want to increase the cost for customers. So they shifted away from recyclable material because they had to add the cost that then claimed back and shifted back to non-recyclable material.
Which makes me think that the pressure has to come from the consumer rather than from the authorities.
And it is.
I have to say to the company that's giving me that, hang on, I want something that's recyclable.
Yes, and businesses have to be able to make a profit out of it as well, because it's about making it as easy as possible for the consumer and as cost effective for the business. If it's going to massively damage their profit margins without consumer pressure, they're not going to make
you
that
change. Couldn't see this, but Sharon behind you was nodding. She thought you made a wonderful point there, didn't you, Sharon?
I did. The cost of the plastic is so important, and right now the price. I mean, my problem with it, with all of this, is the price of the reprocessing of the plastic and the end of life of that plastic is not incorporated in the cost at the till. And that goes for all the plastic products that we've become accustomed to.
But do you think if that was explained to consumers, they would then put the pressure, as Emma is suggesting, back on the manufacturers to make sure that there was an end-of-life plan, as you put it, the funeral costs for all of this plastic?
Yeah, I do. Because I work with the public and with businesses looking for solutions and material alternatives. And the problem with the alternatives in terms of material science is a lot of the alternatives are far more expensive. At the same time, the consumers are saying to me, well, you know, we could move down, you know, how can I go plastic free? It's so difficult. Why are there not more compostable plastics? Well, people, there's a lot of mislabeling as well around a lot of these products. And the problem with the recycling is mixed recycling. And things like PET, so the plastic bottles, have a higher value at the end of life, yet something, you know, like a crisp packet, much harder to recycle, very low value. So there's nobody taking that. Yet the price of the till doesn't include that. So if there was more reflection in that cost at the till, then there could be more infrastructure.
Or alternatively, people might not buy it. Do you notice, Diana, that if you put the cost up because something's really, really good for the environment, that people stop buying it?
So the really funny thing is that one of my most expensive products, I do try to have a price range that goes from the affordable to stocking a couple luxury products that some people really enjoy. And the funny thing is that actually, when I explain to them that, oh, that deodorant is more than you've paid before, but that's gonna last you 6 months, a lot of people are willing to try it, so that's going back to that behavior change. Another thing too, when we're talking about cost and we're talking about plastic pollution, is just to remember that it's also about what you already have in your home. So if you have plastic Tupperware containers in your home, use them, and use them for years. That, you know, you don't have to have that Instagram, you know, just the fashionable.
I've got my lunch in one just out there. Yeah.
Fantastic. Keep using it. Don't buy one, you know, every 6 months or so. But just use what you have. And there's so many things in charity shops as well that there are ways to.
This isn't just about your business. This is about you. You're evangelical about
this.
No,
absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, the reason why I started my business was just one day about a year and a half ago. Just I was in a supermarket and I had a pile of my groceries, and I was just tired of it. I was tired of this going home, unwrapping all the plastic. So it was just one consumer. I'm just, you know, quite ordinary, and I just wanted to make that change.
Let me ask you something, because you're from Canada.
I am.
I don't know whether it's the same as in the United States, but when I lived in the United States, those paper bags used to annoy me because they didn't have proper handles and you couldn't carry quite a few at a time.
Yeah.
But that's a small issue. When it comes to making a paper bag, and how long it lasts, it is actually probably more of a criminal in this than the plastic bag.
Yes, not something I know particularly a lot about, but we were talking about this before, and I remember that you said it was much more damaging to use paper bags because of how they're made.
Yeah, I mean, approximately, if you have a paper bag versus a plastic bag...
But this just doesn't compute with the public
exactly,
at the moment, does
and this
it?
Is why it's so complicated. If you were to show anybody generally and say, what would you prefer to use, a plastic bag or a paper bag? Most people would say paper bag, and there's lots and lots of supermarkets that are being very evangelical about saying, we're removing all our plastic bags and going to paper bags. If you look at the overall carbon footprint, so the whole life cycle of that product, you'd have to use a paper bag maybe three times for it to even come close to the less amount of carbon in its life that a single plastic bag would have.
See, this is what I don't get, Claire, therefore, because you're saying don't use plastic. You're driving people towards paper
bags. No, not at all. It's a very, very complex issue. And the thing is with a paper bag, yes, it might have a higher carbon footprint. Yes, you should use it more than once. You should use it multiple times. But you could actually compost that at home, as long as it's not lined with anything like polyethylene, which a lot of the coffee cups are lined with. So as long as it's a pure paper bag, you
can
put that in a
compost
bag.
How long would it take to break down? I know people sometimes put them in their flower beds to prevent weeds coming up.
Yeah, it's great to prevent weeds.
Yeah.
If you look at it from a marine perspective, if that paper bag escapes into the marine environment, it will degrade and it will produce minimal harm or negligible harm. If a plastic bag goes into the marine environment, even if it's a compostable plastic bag,
I know, but it will last forever. You talk about the circular solution here.
Yes.
The problem is that that paper bag has taken much more energy to make it. Therefore, it's put more CO2 into the atmosphere. Therefore, warming up the oceans, which is doing probably as much harm or more harm.
From a perspective of talking to like the general Joe public, plastic is a bad material, but we need to expand out this conversation. Now people are understanding more about the material. We need to understand more, because what is the most pressing issue we have? It isn't plastic, it's climate change.
Yeah, so therefore plastic bags are worse than, I mean, paper bags are worse than plastic bags.
On a whole life cycle and a carbon footprint, yes, they probably
are. How do you get that idea across to everybody, Sharon?
Right now, plastic has got into the public conversation and people have got passionate and people started doing cleanups and beach cleanups and people have started to delve into this. And then the next thing that's happened, people have hit the supermarket aisles and realised actually this is a lot more complicated than we thought. But if we, you know, things like taking plastic away from everything, people are realizing that if we just went completely plastic free, food waste for a start would be astronomical. We need some plastic in the supply chain to keep food fresh to get to us.
But we could use a recyclable material, a compostable material that is neither plastic nor paper. It is out there and it is being used. Why don't we shout about that more?
We should be shouting about that more, and that needs to, that's what people need to know about. To some extent, though, we need to start with the companies that are making the packaging. Some of the reasons for this that we're not moving to that are economic. So at the moment, we haven't got the composting facilities. If we went to compostable material, that does not mean that you can just take this plastic and put it in your compost bin at home. Compostable on an industrial, when we talk about compostable goods, we mean it goes to an industrial composter. So at high temperature, it composts down over months.
And I suppose the way I was trying to describe is it's something that breaks down very easily and does no harm, but perhaps can do so good. You were nodding at that, Emma, but the problem is getting the cost across again, isn't it? Because you're from an economic background. To research these new materials, to get them into production, is not a tomorrow, well, it's not a today answer, is it?
No, but it is something we need to be looking at. I think one of the things we've mentioned at the Institute for Economic Affairs is that the person who's going to solve climate change isn't a government minister or a civil servant. It's an entrepreneur, it's an innovator. It's someone who's got an idea, who says, okay, how can I make this as effective as possible, as cheap as possible? And that's true for a lot of things, not just about climate change. But banning things, trying to put up prices for consumers is not going to be the answer. It's not going to drive the innovation that we need.
And you've also got to get that light bulb moment for the public so that they think, hang on, I love that idea.
Yeah.
And that's what's changing. Is it perhaps people's approach to life like this?
Absolutely. So at the market stalls that I host with the weekly shop, I always ask people kind of what they're doing already, and people think that they are doing nothing, but I often ask them, do you have a tote bag or do you have that coffee cup? And most people already do.
By tote bag, you mean just something you carry your food around in?
Or I mean,
if you go to the supermarket, don't put it into a plastic bag, just bung it at the bottom of your...
Sure.
Yeah.
I mean, or how many, you know, you go to so many conferences, so many people have plenty of tote bags by this point, or even things like pillowcases. I know people take those and reuse those into cotton bags as well. We have materials at home.
Do you use plastic? Has everybody here ever had a plastic-free day?
No.
No.
Not a...
No.
Oh, you said yes.
Well, a single...
Everybody else said no, you said yes.
So there's something called Plastic-Free July, and that is a pledge, and that is a month-long campaign that's happening next month, and that is the one month that I really, really try to go plastic-free. But we're talking about single-use plastic, but if you talk about plastic, the moment you touch your debit card, your credit card, you're always touching plastic.
Nylon.
It is all around us. It's in our clothing.
Yeah.
So, no, it is impossible to have
completely... I think we need to be really clear when we talk about plastic, what plastic we've got a problem with.
Yeah.
The fact is, the reason that we've been using plastic for 100 or so years is that it's great. it's really cheap, it can do a lot of things, it keeps out bugs, it keeps out moisture, it's actually a brilliant material. It's the ways in which we use it that are a problem, and it is single-use plastics that are the biggest issue.
Because you're not going to reuse a straw that somebody else has sucked.
Not a plastic one.
No, you're not going to.
Maybe a metal one that can be, you know, hygienically washed potentially.
Yeah.
Yes.
We've got schemes in Brighton where bars actually use stainless steel straws, which is on a deposit return. So you get a stainless steel straw
for
£2.
Why not? Not bother with a straw at all? I mean, that would be my point
agree.
Of view.
I mean, when I've been doing talks and a child came up to me and said, "Why do we even have straws?" It's like, well, for 99% of us, we don't need a straw. Some people do for medical reasons.
Oh, okay, get that.
But most of us don't because we can pick up something and we can drink. Apart from a milkshake. I would struggle to eat a milkshake maybe
without a
straw.
You'd end up with a milky moustache if you did that, which wouldn't necessarily be
a
good look. At which point we have to leave it. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sharon, up there. Great to hear all the work you're doing, and thank you to each and every one of you. I'm sorry if I appeared a little bit cynical about some of the ideas, but it is such a circular argument, isn't it? It's difficult to get your head around it. But at least we're talking.
Great.
Thank you very much indeed. And talking about recycling, do come back to watch the next edition of Roundtable. But for now, that is it from me, David Foster, from the team. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.